Advertising in Middle English means to notify. Advertising is a mix of science, psychology, formulas, and is incredibly innovative. This art of persuasion is a way to tap into people's subconscious and motivate them to purchase. So how does a little box in your living room tell you what lifestyle and products you need, but also how you should behave? Hello, my name is Shaunak Neogi, and come along as we travel back in time to Madison Avenue and the suburbs to see how television commercials were a driving force to communicate and advertise new societal norms. We'll also be analyzing how advertisers saw this new population boost and economical rise as an opportunity to create new consumer needs in the 1950s. The point of advertising? Buy a product. The means? Communicating new desires. Now that's rocking.
He rocks in the treetop all the day long, hopping and a bopping and a singing his song. All the
So what was going on in the 1950s that caused Madison Avenue to erupt? Well, that's a good question. See, during Great Depression, the average American family was suffering from unemployment and low wages. Then during World War II, over 2 million married couples had to live apart and not have children. Women were working in factories, nursing, and trying their best to take care of children all by themselves. Children were supporting their family by taking in low-wage jobs. People were struggling. Then came in the 1950s.
One threw a party in the county jail. The prison band was there, they began to wail. The band was jumping and the joint began to swing. You should have heard it knocked out.
Coming out of World War II, which was a time of great sacrifice by the American people, prosperity, peace, and a predictability became the norm. It was a perfect atmosphere for advertising and those brands that understood the power of reaching out to an audience. It was a wonderful, fertile time for them. You have to remember, when it comes to advertising, the answer to all your questions comes down to two things: money and the audience. What is an audience thinking or feeling? What are those emotional or physical needs that a manufacturer or a brand can satisfy?
This marked a shift to a new kind of family goal. Women were getting married quicker, the average age being 20, divorce rates were stabilized, and the birth rate doubled. Hello, baby boom.
In 1952 alone, 3.9 million babies were born. With this new family love and economic growth, families needed more space and a large home. So, welcome to the suburbs, and let me introduce you to the nuclear family: mom, dad, sister, and brother. The nuclear family was the idea of stability, and something folk craved for after the war. Husband earns the wages, comes through mother taking care of the children and cooking, and the children finally being able to just be young and learn their duties.
With the mold to base their advertisements on, companies now knew how to reach certain demographics using stereotypes. You wanted to be the nuclear family? Well, advertisements had the blueprint. Children were amazing targets. In the 1950s, children finally became emotional assets rather than economical ones. Companies knew mom and dad only wanted best for their precious son and daughter. They created jingles that got stuck in their sweet son's head so that mom would eventually purchase the product for them.
Ball, football, basketball, a crew. What sparks a champion? Sparks you and champions. Choose Wheaties.
It was also common in the early ages of television commercials for the commercial to be presented by the same actor in the accompanying program. Advertisements would play during a child's favorite show, and in age-appropriate language, the show would communicate a candy bar or gender modeling products for the children. This way, the child could go to mommy or daddy and tell them exactly what cereal they want or what toy they love. Commercials like G.I. Joe would communicate for the boys, and Barbie doll commercials told girls how to look, how to act, and how to play.
When I grow up, I want to be a mommy.
You can play mommy right now with Ideal's Betsy Wetsy.
But who held the real purchasing power in the house? Who were advertising moguls like Ogilvy and Mather creating content for? Well, mother knows best, right? Ah, the housewife. She was to be a beautiful wife and an amazing mother. Also, she was the motherlode of purchasing power. To convince the mother to buy products for her family,
companies had to have really unique selling propositions for their products. Simply put, this was the why. Why should I buy this? Need to lose that baby weight? We have a product for you. Want to be more attractive and have younger looking skin for your husband? We have a product for you. There was an obsession of body image, and weight came into play. And women wanting to buy everything. Domesticity was a powerful one. Women wanted to be the very best wife for their working husbands. But this idea did not just communicate the products, but also communicated an idea of oppression, one that is often criticized today.
Right now, at the end of aisle two, I've set out a brand new, can't-miss, husband-pleasing coffee.
Your coffee, sir.
Thanks, beautiful.
You're welcome.
How can such a pretty wife
make such bad coffee?
I heard that.
The issue of gender conformity did not seem like a problem then. But you see, as advertisements were being made, more and more of them had this common theme. Women are dependent on men, and their every action is to please the man. They needed products like cleaning products, drugs, clothing, and home appliances to make their domestic duties easier. The constant televised stereotypical gender imagery heavily influenced people's perception.
She's got a man she's promised to love, honor, and...
keep house for the right way.
Does that mean I never have to help with the dishes?
Never.
Advertising is a science. How to go from selling products to creating a need for it. People really believe the claims on some of these ads. And believe me, some are wild. And as we discussed, many ads were targeted towards specific people. Mother and children, teenagers, even immigrants, who needed to be taught how to be classy and be squeaky clean.
Before the big game, there's generally a rally. Now, you don't want to be late, but before you go, remember...
Hey, Susie Q, what's cooking with you?
Your teeth look whiter than new.
My teeth aren't new, but my toothpaste is new Pepsodent.
This content just showed how one would not get the job, girl or husband, unless they were clean. The strategies used were extremely crucial to make sure consumers understood the message. Initially, advertisements were very simple, repetitious, and a little boasty. Think a hard sell. Jingles are a short song or tune that is used to promote a product and is usually meant to get stuck in your head.
Choo 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 crack caramels, choo crack caramels, choo crack caramels, choo crack caramels. Buttery smooth. The longer you chew them, the better you like them.
By repetitious, I mean the idea of three would stick in people's mind and was known to be advertising gold. Advertising gold. Advertising gold.
She wears a smile brush, three ways clean.
Cleaner breath, cleaner taste, cleaner teeth. Three ways clean is Colgate clean.
Those of us in advertising like to look back at the emergence of Doyle Dane Birnbach, which was an advertising agency started by Bill Birnbach and some of his associates, as sparking the creative revolution that added the fun as well as the glamour and money and prestige that came with advertising. So the world of Mad Men actually did exist. And really became one of the largest industries. It's a reason why Madison Avenue became associated with that whole industry. And that's what it was. It was that creative revolution that started with the simple act of putting a writer and an art director together in the same room.
In the 1950s, advertising on television cost $10,000 to $20,000 for a one-minute spot. 30-second spots during the 2020 Super Bowl was $5.6 million. Okay. The strategies have been modified, the jingles have new tunes, but one thing has not changed. Brands want to communicate what they have to offer to their customers. We see this actively today, as many brands revamp their marketing and advertising material to align with core values they want to attach to their brand name. The history of advertising is very fascinating. It has evolved so much as society as a whole changes. Each decade has its own unique style. And although very controversial for its own appropriate reasons, very influential. The 1950s, consumers striving for the American dream became the advertiser's dream decade.
Mr. Sandman.